Lord be with you, and good morning, and welcome on Reformation Day to St. Paul's Lutheran in New Cumberland, Pennsylvania. This is Reverend Jennifer Richards. My friends call me Pastor Jenny. I am so glad to see you here this morning, and welcome. The scripture that was in my head as I was driving to church this morning is from Philippians 1:6. He who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it in you. What a powerful message to get in your head as you're driving to church in the morning. He who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it in you. What a great message. And I know that you're, as brothers and sisters in Christ, totally getting what I'm saying there, that God is at work in us and God will continue to be at work in us. I have a few announcements for the life and community of the congregation, so I'm going to share those with you. As you can tell, it's red here this morning. That is the color of the church calendar for Reformation Day, the day that the Lutheran Church and many of us Protestants recognize in the church calendar as a time for focusing on grace, that what saves us is the gift of Jesus Christ to us as people. Thank you again to Miss Karen for that beautiful music. She's going to stick around so we can sing together and accompanied even the Lutheran anthem, A Mighty Fortress. So start warming up your voices back over there while I share the announcements this morning. The congregation of St. Paul's will be having a congregational meeting in December on the 13th following the 9 a.m. service, and we're going to try to find a way so that folks who cannot physically be present for that meeting will be able to know and have their voices heard. So I'll get back to you about that. We're also working on Christmas Eve, and how are we going to do that too? So be prepared for more updates as we go. Speaking of updates, our office administrator, Jim, has asked for those of us who have newsletter articles for the November-December newsletter to please ASAP get that paperwork in. So if you've got something to share with the community, whether it's a thank you note or something you want to share about the ministries that are happening in our church or in your life, please do pass those along so we can share them with the community. Next Sunday is All Saints Day. It's the day when we remember those who've died since the last 1st of November. And believe it or not, this year, the 1st of November is Sunday. So All Saints Day is falling on All Saints Day. We'll worship on Sunday, All Saints Day. So if you know someone who has died in the past year and you'd like me to include their name in our prayers for next Sunday, please do let me know. Karen will hopefully stick with me and we'll find a way to maybe toll a bell or something, Karen, during that time of recognition of names. It's also daylight savings next weekend, so if you show up an hour early because we fell back and you don't see me there, just come back an hour later look for me, because we're gonna put the clocks back. All right, I have a message from Pastor Sharon, who is a friend of this congregation and has served in this congregation. She is also battling cancer, and she received a prayer shawl from this congregation, and she wanted the community to know that that prayer shawl has been going with her to her cancer treatments, and she finds that prayer shawl to be a way to remain connected to this community and to remember the prayers that we are sharing and care producing for her. Our prayers to God, requesting comfort and strength and healing of her body. So just an update from Pastor Sharon. She says thank you. Those are the announcements that I have, with the exception of a request to you. Would you kindly please pass along your prayer requests to the community here via the message where you're responding here, right? You're saying good morning. I see so many folks there saying good morning. I'm glad to see you. I'm going to scroll down. So If you've got the ability to post in there folks that you'd like to have prayed for later on in the service, please do that, and I'll ask Jim then to forward to me the names in a text, and we'll have everybody prayed for. All right. All the announcements aside, let us take a moment to quiet our hearts and minds as we prepare for worship. We begin by calling on God's name. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. We'll take a moment of silent reflection for that. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Beloved brothers and sisters in Christ, God hears the cries of all who call out in need. And through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. Well, I know that you who are following along here know a mighty fortress is our God, and we're going to sing it with the gusto that we've got for this morning. And let's do all four verses since it's our anthem, okay?
No other God we claim.
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And also with you. Let us pray the prayer of the day. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel, and bestow on the church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading comes from the prophet Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, beginning with the 31st verse. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm is a powerful psalm. I would take this one out and plaster it somewhere in a bathroom or in a devotional book or whatever and just meditate on it. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth be moved and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day. The nations rage, and the kingdoms shake. God speaks. And the earth melts away. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come now, regard the works of the Lord, what desolations God has brought upon the earth. Behold the one who makes wars to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. I'm going to move over the second reading from Romans because I got a hefty sermon today and I want to get right to the gospel. So, the Holy Gospel is from John, but I'm going to sing the gospel acclamation. Maybe you'll join with me as we begin this time. Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go?
Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, if you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, we are descendants of Abraham, and we've never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean you will be made free? Jesus answered them, truly I tell you, everyone who commits a sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. All right, so here I'm going to ask you to do something with me online. I want you to take a look at your hands for a minute. Take a look at them. Okay. What have you taught your hands to do in your lifetime? Can you type? Can you play an instrument? Can you cook a dinner? Well, maybe my hands can't do that very well. How many different things have your hands accomplished over the years of your life? Can you paint or sew or braid hair? My hands have learned a bit of sign language. I wonder if you can read what I'm saying. Just using my hands, it says, I love you. I learned some songs in sign language. Do you know some sign language? I know in New York, I was joking with the first service, hands can be used to speak very loudly, and maybe not in very positive ways. And I'm sure you've seen that around here as well, or wherever you live. Your face can even share, even beyond what your hands can do. If you don't mind, I'd like to ask you to do me a favor and take a picture of the ways in which your hands serve others and send it to me. Now, if you can do it right now because you've got your phone and you could take a picture, have somebody take a picture of you praying, so your hands folded or something like that, or washing the dishes, so you're caring for your family, things that you're doing with your hands, maybe you're petting your pet and you're encouraging it. Take a picture and post it so I can see, and we can, the rest of us can see who are in worship today, ways in which your hands are being used to care for this world. Go ahead and do that if you've got a minute while I'm continuing to speak. Over the past few weeks, I've been caught by the imagery of the biblical texts that use hands. You remember a couple of weeks ago when I was preaching about a foreign leader named Cyrus. God took Cyrus by the right hand. Now, in biblical language, that means God kind of said, "You're mine, kid." Even though he didn't know God, even though he wasn't an Israelite or a Judean or anything of the Jewish faith, and he was actually part of the enemy side, God said, "This is my guy," by taking him by the right hand. In the text from Jeremiah this morning, God has taken the folks he's speaking about, their ancestors, that is the Jews of Israel and Judah, by the hand to bring them out of Egypt, where they were slaves. You know that story, right, of Exodus? God took them out of Egypt through, with Moses leading the way. God took them by the hand. In the gospel lesson for this morning, Jesus is speaking to the ancestors of those Jews that were listening to Jeremiah. And what is Jesus doing in this text from John? Where is Jesus? Well, this is a holiday that Jesus and his Jewish relatives and friends were celebrating. It's called the Feast of Tabernacles, or Sukkot, which celebrates the harvest as well as the Jewish exodus from Egypt. Important to note. Thus, we may wonder why the Jews who were talking with Jesus, what they were thinking when they countered Jesus' statements by saying, "We've never been a slave to anyone." I mean, seriously, they're literally in the temple on Sukkot celebrating the fact that it is God who led them out of slavery. And here Jesus is speaking about freedom and being enslaved. Well, what happened is Jesus is playing on words. And it's a little confusing because the language that he's using is talking about sort of like a slavery to the Romans. And of course, they've never been, quote unquote, slaves in Rome or to the Romans. So it's insulting if you take Jesus at his literal sense as he's speaking. I wonder if it was like that for the folks who were listening to Jesus then. And for those of us who listen to God, or listen to people talk about God, I mean, if it's confusing and maybe it seems like we're speaking another language, What I mean here is that Jesus was talking about freedom and slavery and being set free by the Son, who has a permanent place in the household. It's like he just made no sense unless you take him literally. And if you do, then as a Jew, he's talking crazy language. I mean, no one is the Son of God except those who are apostates or people who don't believe in God. I mean, who does this guy think he is? And we, as Christians, those of us who are gathered around this screen today, use a lot of religious terms. We use words like sin and truth. And we think we know what we're talking about, and we just use it with other people, and they think they know what we mean by what we're talking about. And then when people get all bent out of shape, thinking that we're so judgmental, it's frustrating because that's not what we meant to say. That's not what we're saying. Okay. What we are saying makes no sense sometimes in this world. But what we do with our hands and our lives speaks volumes. Maybe that's why God sent Jesus into the world, because just talking through the prophets wasn't getting it all done. This past week, as pastors, we've been doing some training about church and what's happening in the church. One of the leaders, who also happens to be a pastor of the training, suggested that we change the Lutheran ELCA tagline. The tagline was, or is, God's work, our hands. And he's suggesting that we change it to God's word, our voice, God's work, our hands. And I think it's because he's trying to say that we and our lives, our voices, what we say and what we do, is speaking God into the world. It is, in fact, the language that people are seeing God in. That's how people are knowing Jesus. I'm seeing now that our lives and how we use our voices and our hands will be making a difference in the world in a whole lot of different ways these days. It's going to be the language that other people get to meet Jesus with. Inviting folks to come inside the doors of the church in the building may seem impossible. I mean, you guys aren't even here. I can't see you physically in here. I can't even see your faces. It's COVID-19, and it's not safe to invite people in the building. And yet there are some brave folks who still make it in. And then to ask somebody to watch an hour long of this church service, once again, watching a talking head is really more for us insiders than it is for folks who may be interested in just checking out church or knowing what we believe. It's going to take a reformation of the church again. That's what they were telling us in church in our studies this past week. And I think it's true. It's going to take a new way to speak and teach. I've got to say that even regular church-going folks have found that online church really isn't doing it for them either. Like, when I first started doing online, I was outside in the backyard, you know this, and there were a whole lot of people checking out church, and now we're you know, back to the way it was with just a few folks going to church, even online. Something's missing. I told the early service what a group of us pastors were talking about. Maybe we need to light a candle of coffee hour. Something scented that way. What we're missing is relationship with each other. Thankfully, we can message each other here, so I can see good mornings and happy birthdays to one another, but the fact is that it's still something that's missing. Being able to see your face and the smiles and the laughter. God's church must adapt again. Well, good thing it's Reformation Day, so I can talk about that. We must reform again. A shift from sitting in the building for an hour a week, inviting folks to meet Jesus here is something completely different to what is going to need to take place for the church of today. But only God can do in us what is needed. It's like Jeremiah says, no longer will they teach one another or say to one another, know the Lord, for God will write it on their hearts. And what does God mean by that? I think it may mean that our very lives are the message now. Just inviting folks to the church building on Sundays isn't the answer. No, seeing Jesus in you is what it will take. For God has written it on your heart. God has written God's law on your heart, and it's already on their hearts too. And that connection between you and others is what's speaking. And that connection is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is working amongst us. Let's consider this, okay? Let's consider what Jesus does with his life. In the very same chapter of John that we hear about today, where Jesus is in the temple for Sukkot, just before he talks about all this freedom and language of slavery and being set free, he's sitting in the temple, and the religious leaders of his day bring to him a woman caught in adultery in order to test him. They wanted to know what he would say about the law of Moses, which commanded that they must stone such women. That's the law. She was caught in adultery. Jesus, you're a religious leader. You must follow the law of God. And what does Jesus do? Do you remember this story? He bends down and he starts writing something in the sand with his finger. Then he stood up and he said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And then do you remember what happens next? One by one, beginning with the elders, those religious leaders, the older ones, one by one, they went away all the way down to the youngest until Jesus was left alone with the woman. I wonder what he wrote in the sand. It's not in the Bible, and lots of people have wondered over the years, what did Jesus write in the sand that would have made all these guys who were so adamant on following the law and catching Jesus and catching this woman and following Moses' law? I wonder what Jesus wrote in the sand. I wonder if he wrote something like, "Hey, we're all made in God's image. Even she is. According to God, she's precious. We are loved. We are set free and forgiven." I don't know, part of the snarky side of me says maybe he wrote their names in there because he knew who the other adulterer was. I don't know, that's kind of ridiculous. But what I think that's really happening here is that Jesus is trying to talk about freedom, and that we are so precious, she's so precious in the sight of God, that we cannot sit in judgment of her. If God has set her free, if God has set us free, if God has forgiven, how can any of us not forgive? Jesus calls us to follow him. He asks us to set aside all that judgy stuff, the judgment that the church is full of. Why do you think people are like, "I don't want to come to church"? Because it's full of judgment. And maybe even people who do come to church look at each other and like, "Oh, they're so judgy of me." Or maybe you're the one judging others. And we need to stop this judginess. The law is all about, you know, putting people in their place and reminding them that there are 10 commandments. We must follow these and be perfect about it. We need to end the use of God's word about law, to use it to break people or enslave people, to using God's law to reduce others. Because that's not why God gave us the law. God gave us the law to bring delight and hope. This is the law that Jesus said was the most important. Do you remember it? the most important law that Jesus wanted us to remember. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Stop judging. God, stop judging. Neighbor, stop judging yourself. I got that voice, those voices in my head that say, oh, you did it again. Why are you so dumb, right? Or, oh, I just can't get it right. My life isn't right. Like, I need to fix everything. Listen, we need to stop all of that language and hear what God is saying through Jesus Christ. This is what God says through Jesus Christ later in the gospel. Jesus uses those hands to stretch them out, right, on the cross. And those crucified hands, after his resurrection from the dead, are used again. We find in the end of the Gospel of John that Jesus meets the disciples after his resurrection. He makes breakfast for them. He breaks bread and gives it to them, and he feeds them the fish that were caught. Now, that's pretty powerful business for guys who witnessed Jesus dying, and now they see him alive and feeding them. No wonder the church exploded. Because Jesus didn't just speak, he used his life and calls upon us to do the same. That is how the church grows. That is how lives are changed, by our hands and voices being used, not to judge, but to show love, to feed. Jesus does with his hands and with his life the things that speak volumes. He uses his life to set people free. And being people of God, you know what I mean by being set free. So here we are with our hands left open, rocks of judgment dropped. You may not judge. I may not judge myself or anyone else. For God loves each one of us. And God has given us to love on God and to love each other. For those who were in the building this morning, they used their hands to crack open the body and blood of Christ and to have communion together. For those of us who are at home or online at worship today, we have hands that are free to splash the waters of baptism over us, or take your hand right now and make the sign of the cross over yourself. We can align our lives to that cross, which reminds us of how far those hands of Christ would go, all the way into loving us. So what will you do with your hands today to show others who Jesus is? What will you do with your hands? Ah, I see Bill has made a sign of the cross. What will you do with your hands today? I'd love to hear from you. Tell us what you will do with your hands to show the love of God into the world today. Let us pray. God, thank you for giving us bodies to serve, to show who you are in the world. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Cross the divide that COVID-19 has put in the way. Help us to see one another and the needs of our neighbors. Use us that the reformation of the church may happen, that folks who cannot literally walk into buildings may still know of your love. Bless our time together, Lord, in your name we pray. Jesus, amen. All right, so our hymn for the day, let me see, I've got to pull this open here. Our hymn for the day is That Priceless Grace.
That priceless grace. grace, that priceless grace, that priceless grace which gave me life. Jesus, life is priceless grace. That priceless grace is life for me. That priceless blood, that priceless blood, that priceless blood was shed for me. Jesus' blood is priceless grace. That priceless grace is life for me. That painful death, that painful death took sin away. Jesus' death is priceless grace. That priceless grace is life for me. That precious word, that precious word which brought me life. Jesus' word is priceless grace. That priceless grace is life for me.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So if you've got some prayers to share, now is the time. I've got several names that were shared at the very first service. And I know that there are some birthdays coming up here. I was reminded. Let's see, of a couple of birthdays. I know Elizabeth's birthday is coming up, and I think there was a birthday at the very first service as well. If you know whose birthdays are up there, please do send me a message so I can remember everybody, okay? Otherwise, add your prayers in there, and I'll add them in as time comes for prayers. Let us pray. With confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Renew and inspire the church in the freedom of the gospel, O God. Where the church is in error, reform it. Where the church speaks your truth, strengthen it. Where the church is divided, unite it. Ignite in us the working of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the earth changes, as mountains shake and the waters roar, may we care for this planet as a holy habitation for all living things. Sustain all peoples and lands recovering from natural disasters of any kind. I'm thinking today especially of the fires out in the west. I think Colorado is facing two or three of the largest fires that they have seen in history. So we'll continue to keep folks in our prayers in California and in the South after those devastating storms. Okay, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide areas of the world divided or traumatized by conflict, especially in our own land. Free all from slavery and human trafficking and protect all in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Release those living in bondage to debt and chronic pain or addiction. Grant healing touch to those who are ill. Today we're remembering especially Wheezy Edwards, Heather, Pastor Sharon, Bailey, Carter, Trevor, Anita, Ursula, Joan Ruth, Ken Dapp, Jan Barrick, Pat Hefner, my friend Sarah, and anyone else who is struggling with anxiety or depression. We also pray this morning for NA and AA and all who are in our recovery church, and for Dan Kaler. We're also praying for Wanda Fuhrer, who would have been 90 yesterday, and all those who have reminded us of the faith and taught us about God's love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this family of faith, we give thanks for courageous voices who remain firm in their commitment to the one who sets us free from sin and death. Centered in your grace, unify us in the hope of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Today, we're remembering a few birthdays. I guess Tim Dixon has a birthday. And Grace Ann Burks has a birthday, and Tom Melnichuk, that's who had a birthday this morning, okay? Who else has a birthday or an anniversary that we want to remember? I pray that your birthdays and anniversaries are a reminder of the incredible gift that you are to us. We are so grateful for your lives. We love you, and we wish you a wonderful birthday. Even in death, Lord God, you set us free and give us a place in your house. We give thanks for the ancestors who've shown us truth and freedom. We pray especially this morning, or remember especially this morning, Dr. Martin Luther, and those who work for the renewal of the church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Oh, it looks like Kathy Rubel has a birthday. Wow, this is the week for birthdays. Happy birthday to you, Miss Kathy. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. Go ahead and give yourself a hug if you're alone. Hug on somebody else or your little pet if you're near them, and say the peace of Christ be with you to them. As I share this passage and reading from the bulletin. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble, Psalm 46:1. When we are used to an abundant harvest, it can be shocking to experience scarcity. It is wise to remember that God is the source of all things. We all have something to share from God's abundance. Perhaps a smile or a kind word is the blessing someone needs. I mean, I don't read these before I preach, but they seem to like echo what I'm saying here. If you are not in a position to give resources, then by all means, give love and compassion. How about it? That's how you can use your life, even just a smile to someone in need. Maybe take your mask off to do it. I don't know. It seems hard to even smile behind a mask, doesn't it? Well, my friends, we're winding up our worship together, so it's time to enter into prayer once again as we pray the Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught us. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. A blessing for you, Mothering God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you in the way of truth and life. Amen. Our final hymn is going to be with the organ. And we're going to be singing, Rise, O Church, Like Christ Arisen. I'm going to turn the camera so you can see Miss Karen as well on the organ. Okay.
Rise, O Church, like
such poetry. I love it. Beautiful stuff. Oh, my beloved friends, I miss you. I love you. And I sure hope to see you again. Please do post pictures, if you can, of ways in which you're using your life for Jesus Christ. And I wish for you a wonderful, wonderful week. Go in peace and remember the poor. Thanks be to God. We will. And thank you, Dave, for all the hard work you're doing with our online stuff, and Jim, too. Blessings. I'll see you next Sunday.